it goes like this. I understand that the average person, if he looks at a picture, can track the movement of the three objects. I understand that software developers can track the movement of six or seven objects. That's cool. That's very good. I want to test this. So I want to test how you can focus on just two simultaneous things, okay? Because, you know, it's morning and we're sitting in a chair, so we're not going to go for six. We're just going to go for two, okay? So I'm going to ask everybody in the room to identify their right hand and point out your pointing finger, okay? Like this. Great, thank you. Now, your other hand, and I'm going to have the microphone in one hand, so I'm just going to try to show you. Please put your palm, your left hand palm, towards your left neighbor. Okay? Good. Great. Now, what's going to happen is, your right hand with the pointer, you're going to place it in the palm of your neighbor. Okay? Just place it in the palm of your neighbor, and try to place it in a non-hurting way. Great. Good. Now, two things at once. I'm going to count to zero from three. So I'm going to say 3, 2, 1, go. And only when I say go, what you're going to do is two simultaneous things. One, you will protect your finger from your neighbor and you will pull it really, really fast from his palm or her palm. And then with your other hand, you're going to grab the finger of your neighbor, okay? Do this simultaneously. You can do it. You can try six objects. You can do these two things simultaneously, okay? So are you ready? Also, please be careful with nails and things like this. We don't want any accidents. So, we're going to do it like this. We're going to start in 3, 2, 1, go! Who's got gold? Who's got gold? Raise your hands up. Well, good. See? People learn. Okay, good. One more time. Raise your hands again. One more time. Because now you know the drill, so now you're going to be more competitive. Okay? Now, one more time. And we're going to go with 3, 2, 1. Okay, now, this is the part where you were trying to win the situation. Okay, good. We're going to try that again when energy gets a little too low. Okay? We're going to start practicing. We're going to keep on practicing. Okay. Now, our breakfast. We will be talking to three very, very special individuals which will give us an insight regarding the future of, as you can see there, software development. I hope that we can start a discussion here because it's a breakfast and we tend to talk at breakfast. I'm going to invite them here. I'm going to ask each one of them to tell us an insight that they have regarding this future. And then we're going to ask them questions, okay? We're going to go around the room and we're going to ask them questions. So, the first person that I would like to bring here in front is Jiri Tobolka, who's a developer evangelist at Good Data. Please give him a round of applause. Okay. Hello, Jiri.
How are you?
Good. You work for Good Data, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And I'm guessing you use that term a lot when you work, right? Because for example, when you review the work of your colleagues, you go like, that's good data.
Well, you know, everybody wants to have good data, but a lot of people don't have good data. So we are trying to change it.
Okay. Great, good. And who has a personal question for Jiri? Who has a personal question for Jiri from the audience? Not a nasty one, just a small, easy one. Okay.
Hi, can you please stand up? We can see you back here.
Sure.
Good, personal question was answered. Thank you very much. Okay, I think, how about if he stands on the border? Can you see him if he stands on the border? Like on the couch border? Not on top of it.
No, it's new.
It's new? Okay. It's a good couch. Okay, the next person, and I'm going to ask you to wait until I read the full position or the full extent of the the job that this person does, okay? So I'm going to go with this. He's the CEO of CPM, Chief Technology Officer, Director of Architecture, Analytic Architectures, Big Data, and International Speaker. That's a lot, right? It's John Morton. Great to have you with us. That's more titles than the Queen of England.
If you look at my LinkedIn profile, you'll also see a whole bunch of other things I do. I'm also a director on one of the UN groups who's looking at something that you might all be interested in. What is the IT industry going to look like in 2020, which covers jobs, skills, and drives the UN agenda for a 20% growth in the GDP of the IT industry worldwide. So if you want to know about some odd things that are happening in the world, I probably can get all of the information if I don't already know. But I'm also doing some stuff with FIPO and the Sophia framework around career paths, job descriptions, and how to become more professional and prove that you are a professional in this market. And that's just two.
Okay, great. Well, so I need to add here with the description the next positions that you have in 2020.
I've got them already.
You've got them already, great. Okay, and the third person will be Robert Jenkins, who's the CEO in Cloud Sigma. Please give him a big round of applause.
So it's a little bit hard for you in different time zones because you've got stuff to
do. Great, good. And now, who wants or who can ask a question to Robert?
Hi, first of all, we've all heard about Jenkins.
I didn't invite Jenkins.
What was your initial thought of Romania when you heard that you're going to visit Cluj and Romania?
Actually, I was very interested because I remembered the city of culture thing, which of course is not Cluj, but that kind of was interesting. And I live in Sofia, in Bulgaria, so it's not a million miles away. And I've only been to Bucharest once, so I was looking forward to it because I've never been to Cluj and I knew it's a tech hub. So for me, it was interesting.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'm guessing you guys are going to have to stand up, right? Because if you sit on the couch, then the people in the last rows won't be able to see you. Am I right here? Give me some feedback in the back. Are you... Okay, so I'm guessing you're going to have to stand.
That's okay.
That's it.
Okay. Yeah. Great. Of course, that means that we can see you when you ask us the questions later.
Yeah, that's even better. So, I'm going to leave it now to you guys to just start from whomever wants to start. Give us an insight regarding the future of software development, each one of you, and then we will take some questions from the audience. All right? So, who wants to start?
Okay, so, well, when I think about the future of software development, as you heard previously in the keynote, I think maybe the future is now, because there's a lot of tools, crazy amount of apps, huge amount of developers, everybody is able to take his chance to build something awesome. So I think we can start building a future now. And, we'll see in 5 or 10 years.
I was going to say the nature of programming is kind of influenced by what's possible. And what I mean by that is, like today we heard about the importance of APIs already and collaboration, and that's made possible because of the internet, and so services communicate with each other, etc. And so building products and using APIs is just implicit for most people in what they do, and that wouldn't have been the case, you know, 20 years ago. And so the question is, what's going to change in the next 5 years, and how will that then influence the way we build products and services? So obviously one area that's interesting is the kind of machine-to-machine type stuff, and then the volume of data that that produces, and of course the little tracks for this later in the day for everyone. And I see those things as being really interesting, and how will the internet things actually influence the nature of the way we structure products and build services together. And then the other thing is, I think that things will continue to get more collaborative. So we already have that today, and so developers do a lot more integration, and it's about a choice of services and products, and it's not just about building stuff. You still have to build stuff, but it's just as important about fitting, how you fit into the ecosystem and where you're going to be in this ecosystem, and that's just as important as a decision as actually how and what you're going to build.
I think then the response is, you ain't seen nothing yet, because the IT industry, from my perspective, we're at a real inflection point. I think Dan covered part of that. It's not about, you know, throwing away the old stuff, because there's an awful lot of really good old stuff in the background. It's about how we adapt and integrate that into the new world. A lot of the challenges that startups have and technology companies have is they're looking at a proof of value, proof of concept, and a proof of marketplace, but they have still to mature into some of the industrial design processes to actually make that a scalable enterprise-type system. And for many organizations, they're not going to throw away the huge investment in previous infrastructure and technologies. So it's not about we need this type of person or that type of person. We actually have to change some of the academic processes, and we need new academic ways of thinking about things. We talked this morning at breakfast, real breakfast, the breakfast here that was mentioned, about, well, visual computing science with art, because visualization and getting that message across to your user base, to your customer base, is going to be a key area for big data, for IoT, and for consuming cloud services. Where is your computing science with psychology? Because going forward, your engagement strategy with your customers is important, but actually your engagement strategy on a machine-to-machine level and understanding the behavior of machines within their context. Think of a smart meter that happens to be, one of the smart meters happens to be next to an electromechanical device, which then causes interruptions in the data signal. How do you then deal with that? How do you create the data patterns to assess that? So, I guess the question is, what are the sciences, what are the new things that you need to take on board within your jobs at the moment? I'm putting a question back to the audience. Sorry, we are.
Would you like to answer it before the audience does, or?
I think I've given some indications, but, you know, in the job that you're doing, you've got your computer science degree, we know that there's some economists out here, there's probably a few mathematicians, there might be some operational researchers, but when you're doing something, when you're coding something for your customer base, what are you actually saying? I wish I knew more about this, because I need that to do my job. Any volunteers?
Okay.
Well, I think that one of the biggest problems that we are having is that a lot of companies are doing outsourcing for other projects and other companies, and somehow are maybe too far from the customer. And one idea or something that could help in the direction that you mentioned was pushing it to work closer with the customer And as the previous speaker mentioned, knowing your customer and understanding your customer needs, I think that's would be a success towards something like this.
Anybody else? Yeah. I can say something on developers, knowing the customer. So one of the things we do within our company, which is sort of reflects what Dan was saying, was we have something called a day in support, because actually, as far as I'm concerned, the people in support are the most important people in the company, because they have to deal with all the customer problems, and it's really stressful. And I do my days in support as well, as the CEO, and I sit there and I answer the live chat and the problems the customers have for a day. And I can tell you, at the end of the day, you're completely exhausted by the whole thing. But it's actually really great, because then you can just, it just focuses you in on the problems that you have to solve. Because when you see the same thing come up over and over again from, say, support, the customers are asking, when you stick the developer and you put them in the support desk and they are answering these chats all day, and it keeps the same thing, immediately, the next day, they go back to the team and say, oh man, we've got to solve this thing, because it's like really upsetting. And it's really motivating for everybody. So, breaking down the barriers between the different teams, which is a bit of a cliche, but it actually does make a huge difference. It's amazing the difference it makes, just one taking one developer and putting them in the support team for one day, and then the effect it has on the team the next week, in terms of their ability to focus on what's important within the company.
Yeah, I think I have the same experience from Good Data. I've been working across all different departments, developer evangelist, helping marketing, helping developers and support. And I see a huge difference about how everybody understands the customer. For example, you know, support guys are always like, hey, let's help the customer fast, now. Then there is the marketing, you know, they are a little bit just about the reality. And then there is a developer, and developer is like, I don't care, I need to finish my tests, or something like that. And exactly as Robert said, putting developer to support for one day helps a lot. And I know that, for example, API, do you know API.io? Cool, so they are doing exactly this thing. They are rotating developers in support, and they have to answer questions. And then, yeah, the reaction is like, we need to fix this stuff because it's important for our customers.
John, would you like to also give us an insight regarding this subject, and then we'll take a few questions from the audience.
Several insights. So in customer analytics, it's just a programming team, it's not longer an agile team. It's a different management style to bring together marketing, psychologists. Sometimes you've got a social science person involved, especially in some of the government agencies, to use data and data analysis. You have to then have a coding person, and they all have to understand what the outcome is, not about what their individual role is, but how it all fits together. And so you start to get a team mentality that focuses on a range of outcomes for our customers. In smart metering, I think you already could work out that there's a whole range of things around how do you deal with disruptions, electronic management in a machine-to-machine type basis. And therefore you're building algorithms, data scientists, but patterns on top of that, alongside the code, to manage that, to start to move towards an exception management capability for the customers and for machines, so that you then actually manage them. The other challenge on B2B, machine to machine, that's coming out is actually machines no longer one way. You just sense tape. Now you have to go back and actually recalibrate. A lot of times it's rebooting, I wonder why. And starting to look at the more non-functional aspects about how do we keep software updates going, how do we add in new functionality into that end machine, whether it's your fridge, your smart meter, or whatever.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Now, we have about 10 minutes more of this actually 8 minutes more of this talk. So we're going to take some questions from the audience. Okay. So who wants to ask a question regarding the future of software development? Okay, we have there a question. You get two microphones.
Hi. This question is initially to John, but please feel free to jump in. You mentioned you work on the UN and roughly the state of the world currently in programming, and I was wondering what was the thing that most surprised you, and what was the thing that most surprised you in the last 2 years about programming and state of the world currently?
That's a brilliant question. I think the fact that China has given Ecuador $10 billion to rebuild from ground up, from machine semiconductor level, all the way up a brand new computing stack, to get away from the mythical reality that every single American software company and chip manufacturer is sensing information and surveying the rest of the world. When you look at Ecuador, you think, why then? Ecuador, from an economist's perspective, about 8-9 years ago was in real doldrums. It was a monopolized state. It was monopolized by five of the big banks who, through time, had been allowed to really take control of every single aspect of business and social life. They own taxi firms, they own insurance companies, they own everything. The new president, on a democratic license, came in and he broke up all the cartels that were going on. He threw out all international investment, and he's turned around the company, he's being paid the country. They've now moved into one of the fastest growing GDPs within South America, and in addition to that, they've now gone to the next level, which is he's been re-elected, and again, this inward investment. He's focused five of their largest universities to be STEM, scientific, technology, engineering, and mathematics, and only last year he allowed international investment to come back in for their minerals and oil reserves. That in itself, that sort of bravery to actually go back and re-engineer from the ground up, I think is disruptive, but it's also putting a challenge to everybody else to then say, well, is that going to be the best way? It's going to use new scientific methods, new engineering methods, new material sciences, but is that going to be the right way? So we can see a little bit of a battle going on. It's already changed things within Intel. It's already changed things within some of the large software, American software companies as well, about how they're going to deal with that going forward.
Thank you.
Anything else for counsel? Anything else to add?
Yeah.
No. It was a very, very complete answer. Thank you very much. You know. And also, thank you very much for the question. We have time for one or two more questions. Let's see. Who wants to ask a question? Yes.
Hello. My question is regarding education. What's your take on education and its role throughout high school and faculty? And do you think it needs to change in a certain way from the software point of view?
I think you need to try to connect universities to companies and collaborate together. I think it's valuable to have a university degree. I think there might be people who don't need it. You know, about several successful people who doesn't need university degree. But I think it's helpful for for a lot of things to go through the university and then start working or start some business. And I think more collaboration between universities and companies would help a lot.
I was going to say a comment more generally about education, because there's a big movement to have focus on the core sciences. But actually, it's beyond a certain point, it becomes counterproductive. So if you over-focus somebody on, say, doing maths, and there are a lot of studies that show this, you can increase the number of hours they're doing maths, and beyond a certain point, there's a diminishing return, and then beyond a certain, what happens is you tend to cut out things like music and art and things like this, or that can happen. And actually that's worse, it actually brings down the level of performance people have. And they've done studies where they have 1 hour of music and then maths, and those people outperformed, and they even had it where people were doing less maths and more music, and they still got higher marks in maths than people that did no music and almost only maths. So there are a lot of counterintuitive things there. So for me, I think it comes down to balance, and actually, I think that there are a lot of complementary studies that you can do around music and art and things like this, as well as the core sciences. And actually, if I look at the people that we have in our development teams, almost there are a lot of musicians. We could actually have our own band, and people involved in art and things like that. So actually, those people are successful developers, and they have those interests as well. So I think that it's important to have obviously a good level of standard on those kind of core sciences, but actually, I'm a big believer in having a sort of very holistic education as well.
A good balance.
Yes. Bit of a bleeding plug. I'm actually talking a little bit more about that particular subject this afternoon. But for here, it's not about getting rid of the academic sciences that we've already got, it's about augmenting them. If you look at project management in the ICT world, about 15-20 years ago, there was hardly any of it, and yet now it is seen and respected as a core discipline. If you look at some of the courses that are coming out in the UK and in other places, Berlin, Madrid particularly, you're getting fraud and forensic science, and an awful lot of it is computing science and data science modules. You're getting business analytics and consultancy. These are MSc courses, these are degree courses. So you're starting to see the fact that there is need for not just a depth of knowledge, but an understanding of how you can assemble to order, and more importantly, an assemble to integrate. Funnily enough, in a broader world, we're now seeing some countries some universities putting a focus on how to modernize mainframe core using new Java techniques to wrap around APIs, because those countries don't have some of the technology advances that you might get in Romania, but they want to be able to give their graduates, their undergraduates, an opportunity, and they've tackled that long tail of computing.
I'd like to ask you, what's your opinion on the current state of Agile, considering that, like Don said, it might be dead, and what do you think is coming next?
Well, of course we use Agile, as everyone does, and put it this way, I don't think I don't even want to go back to a sort of waterfall type model, and I agree with what Dan said this morning about being more fluid, and I would say the way we want to move as a company, and what we found is actually, and we didn't really talk about this, we talked about serving the customers, but actually we try more and more, and it works, and we get more engagement with customers, involving them more and more in the product development process, and even they're developing the product, because they want something, and then they come and they help us develop that product, because often they're technical people as well. So it kind of blurs the lines between your company and your customers. And actually, a lot of people that end up working in our company were customers, and people leave our company, become customers. And so there's kind of this blurring. So, because the idea of Agile is that you respond to the customer request, you make a user story, and then you have your sprints, etc. And this is kind of even going beyond that, and it's bringing the customer inside the tent. And actually, it can be a bit scary, because then they can sort of understand what's going on a little bit more. But the idea is that we can bring them inside the tent even more, and then actually developing and working with us on products that we're actually doing internally. And so that's kind of a really good process that we found. And it's kind of, it's basically a kind of community type thing. And you can't fake it as well. So when you see a company that has that, you know they have a good product, because you really can't fake having a whole community of people contributing to your product.
So, I'm shareholder in at least three, probably four startups. And within those, you want to fail fast, learn fast, and really adopt and adapt and move forward. That's the key thing. So we use Agile there. But you get to that tipping point about when does industrial design have to come into what you're actually delivering to your customers. So from my consultancy business, I spent more time looking at Agile failures than probably anything else on my list of other things to do, mainly in the big data world. And the challenge with most companies who are tackling big data is they say, well, we want to be really agile, and we want to go with a whole area that they don't understand. That's one aspect. The other aspect is they assume that because you're doing agile, you've already put in place the framework in which you're going to work. Well, I think everybody here knows the challenges of, right, we've built a product, or we've got something out the door, now let's go back and put in security. Oh, let's go back and put in data lineage, because we forgot that actually we're doing financial services, and we need to make sure that we've got the data lineage in place. So my challenge around anybody who starts on an agile journey is make sure that they've actually got a framework architecture in place that looks at the standards and regulations before they start scoping up the sprints and understanding what they're going to deliver. Agile isn't new to me. We used to call it prototyping in the 80s. In the 90s, there was JAD and RAD and DSDM. And today, we're calling it all about Agile and Scrum. It's all about how quickly can we respond to a customer's needs. Fundamental for large organizations, and I work quite a lot with large organizations, is our reuse strategy and getting towards that assemble to integrate, assemble to build type model, building on code that you can trust in your life.
What to add? Well, I think, yeah, Agile is a tool or a Scrum, if you will. And I think it's about the people. I think it shouldn't be like a management decision to tell people, hey, you will do Agile in this way or this way. I think the people and programmers need to want to do that, and then you can get them the opportunity to work in Scrum or Kanban or something different. It's not, it's simply, I think it shouldn't be the management decision, but I think that all have to be for that.
Okay. Well, from my understanding, if Agile is a god, then it's a god, right? No, you don't think so, okay. Then, the one who you said is a god, right? And gods don't die, right? Only if you stop praying to them, right? Okay, well, Robert, John, Jiri, thank you very much for this talk. Let's give them a big round of applause.
Our failures. So it's not about like success and all this kind of stuff, but it's actually about here are all the things we did wrong and here's how we fix them and the challenges that we had as a cloud operator. So that's like I think it's four in the cloud track.
Great.
And I'm already kind of talking about
this. But you're still going to be around, right?
Yeah.
Great. So people can come if they have any other questions regarding the future of software development, they can come to you and ask them directly, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, great. Thank you so much for coming.
Thanks. Good.